For decades, questions surrounding the murder of 14-year-old Emmett Till focused on the young white storekeeper, Carolyn Bryant. What really happened on that day at the Bryant grocery store in Money, Mississippi? Did Carolyn Bryant lie? Duke University historian Timothy Tyson is the only person who's ever spoken to Bryant on the record in an interview conducted 9 years ago. And her story is the focus of his new book. It's called The Blood of Emmett Till. Nice to have you with us. Appreciate it.
Thanks.
The book is riveting, but literally from the very first line where you talk about essentially your interview with Carolyn Bryant, who we being the public, haven't heard from in 62 years.
Yes.
Tell me first about how long you spent digging into this story about Emmett Till.
Well, 7 years, I guess, total. It's an important story, and it's a difficult story, and it was important to do it right and to get as close to the truth as I was able to get.
Was it hard to get Mrs. Bryant to chat with you?
Well, you know, that was the easiest part because—
Tell me about that.
I got a phone call from a nice woman who wanted to tell me how much she liked my book, my previous book. And then I was sort of being polite, but I was getting off the phone. And she said, well, you know, I gave it to my mother-in-law for Christmas. She really liked it. We'd like to have coffee with you. And I just pretend she hadn't said it and said, well, thank you so much. It's very good. And I was getting off the phone. And she said, well, you might know about my mother-in-law. Her name was Carolyn Bryant.
And
of course,
did you
know,
do?
I'm a historian of the Civil Rights Movement. I know, like, Carolyn Bryant hasn't talked to anybody since 1955, and it's a, you know, it's a very important story.
So you clearly
so I went
took
to
him
interview
up on the
her. Oh, yeah.
Offer for coffee.
I allowed as how I could work that in my schedule, yes.
But so tell me about that meeting. You go and show up at the house, and what happens? What's she like?
She brought me inside. Mm-hmm. She was like every Methodist church lady that I ever knew growing up. She was 74, maybe, something like that.
Frail or in good health?
A little frail. I think she was a little shaky and had bad back trouble, as I recall.
She sat you down and served
you
tea.
Yeah, we had pound cake and coffee. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was, she was very, I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know if I expected her to have horns or, you know, like, but she's very, very ordinary to me.
Did she know that you were going to ask her about what happened in 1955?
Oh, I hardly had to ask. It was clear that I think she was in poor health and getting older, and I think she wanted to have her say, to tell her story before, for posterity, while she could. But I don't know that. That's just how it seemed. And then, so interviewing her was very easy. That was what they had in mind for me to do.
Can I read from page 6
sure.
in your book? So when I said you really, from the go,
yeah.
you really talk about this critical mm-hmm. conversation. You write this, but her testimony that Till had grabbed her around the waist and uttered obscenities, she now told me, quote, that part's not true.
Yes.
Walk me through exactly what she told you. Did she say, I lied?
She didn't use that word. She sort of painted that piece of her testimony and said, that part's not true. And of course, so I asked her what was true, as anybody would. And she said, in a way that's more thoughtful than it sounds, but she said, I would like to tell you, honestly, but I can't remember. She said, you tell these stories until they seem true. But that part's not true.
About grabbing.
And then she said, nothing that boy did could ever justify what happened to him. She was trying to distinguish, she was trying to distinguish between what she remembered and what she knew were the facts of the matter. What do you do when you remember something that's not true, you know? So that was, anyway, she was trying to sort through her memory of things. But
did she seem remorseful? Because that last line,
clearly,
she was.
Clearly, a big burden, a big burden. My father used to say, we're not punished for our sins, we're punished by our sins. Mm-hmm. And it was clear that this had been a big burden for her. But The truth is, she's not the focus of the book. It's not really Carolyn's story. She's just one source. It's important because she's a new source. But, you know, so is the transcript of the trial, which is missing since 1955, which had been disappeared. The FBI found it in 2005. And the FBI report in 2005 had uncovered all kinds of new things. And then the important thing about Carolyn's testimony was really a look inside the Milam Bryant clan and what their worldview was like, so that you could find, you know, how did they get to where that horrifying evil that they were part of. That was, because in some ways, there's a war going on in Mississippi in 1955. The Brown versus Board of Education decision had white people just in a furor. And the NAACP was being very aggressive, pushing to integrate the schools, and then also for voter registration, because black people in Mississippi can count. They know if they can vote, this whole thing's coming down. And so there was terrorism going on. There were voting rights activists being assassinated. You know, and when you start looking at the culpability in the situation, you have to start with President Eisenhower, who said of the white reaction to the Brown decision, he said, all the opponents of desegregation are concerned about is they don't want their sweet little girls sitting with some big overgrown Negroes. He was talking about the same idea that killed Emmett Till.
People who would say, yes, if you're pointing a finger with culpability, you could point it right at Carolyn Bryant.
It's easy to tell the Southern horror story about monsters, you know, but in truth, you know, the federal government refused to protect voting rights. When black Mississippians disappeared, you know, there was no recourse to the courts. You know, America didn't care what happened to black Mississippians.
So sort of the difference between, yes, when we talk about individual racism,
yes,
and racist systems.
Yes. And, you know, individual racism, 1955 in Mississippi, that's just in the water. You know, I'm not trying to, there's no excuse or there's no washing away what they did. It is a story, a horror story in that sense, but its meaning, I think, says more. That narrative really lets America off the hook.
Can I ask you a question about what you write about in Carolyn Bryant has an unpublished memoir?
Yes, which she also gave me, and which is in the archive.
Have you read it?
Yeah, of course. I used it as a source in the book. It's a very short thing. It's not like it's a book-length thing. And it's not publishable, but
what does she say about herself in it? Well, I guess I'm just 62 years later thinking, mm-hmm, this is a woman whose testimony essentially, mm-hmm, was a turning point in American civil rights history, because what she said, mm-hmm, and within a system, yeah, that, yeah, supported that, really caused the absolutely horrific murder of a teenage boy.
There's no apology for what she did, which is evil, but she actually didn't tell her husband that happened. The grassroots activists in Mississippi who investigated this, you know, because the prosecution didn't investigate it worth it, but the grassroots activists in Mississippi found out who told Roy was somebody who hung around down at the store. He was quite angry with Carolyn that she hadn't told him. I'm not trying to get Carolyn off the hook, because she bears some culpability in this.
But in her testimony, she says.
And her testimony was not admitted in the court. The judge sent the jury out because his point was, what is it that could have happened at the store 3 days before the murder that could possibly even be relevant to the murder, right? This isn't self-defense 3 days later, you know. So how could what happened at the store even be admissible in court? And they argued, so he sent the jury out and let her testify. So it didn't, and the narrative that she told is a story that everybody knew, because that was a politically contrived narrative about, you know, the black beast rapist and the fairest flower of Southern white womanhood. You know, this was a politically told tale from the late 19th century. So that story hung over racial politics, the whole thing. So
one has to imagine, she had said, nothing happened.
If she had stood on her head and screamed, they lynched him, and for nothing, they would have acquitted those men. You know, this was not a trial where justice was a possibility. Mm. A student, local boy, went off to school. His father had been a sheriff's deputy, white boy. Went off to school, came back and wrote a paper on this, and he interviewed 9 of the 12 jurors, and every one of them said, of course they knew that Roy Bryant and J.W. Milam had killed that young boy, of course. But he had approached a white woman, you know, he had it coming. So, and they didn't even hear her testimony. Hmm. So that story is sort of already all over this.
How come 9 years passed before you told everyone what I thought it was a bombshell? Well, I'm
honestly
stunned.
You know, I'm a historian, and this is an important American story. And it's not simple. And it was a global story. I mean, the evidence in this thing, to read all that stuff took me 7 years.
But all the more reason to say, oh my gosh, I've just had an interview with the person who's at the center of this case. 9 years ago, she was frail, but certainly less frail than she is
today.
This
may sound crazy to you, but it never occurred to me to have put a press release about my unfinished research. It's just not,
Did it ever occur to you that maybe someone from Emmett Till's family would have wanted to know 9 years ago?
You know, honestly, no, not at the time. I understand that now. But at the time, I was just deep down in trying to figure out this thing and trying to do, it's a hard book. I'm not a victim by any means, but it was excruciating.
Oh, it has
this
to be.
Story,
it reads it is painful to mm-hmm. read this book, and it's a phenomenal book. I mean, really, a walk through the history of that time it was a shocker to me. What do you write about next after this? Or do you take 15 years off to recover?
I'm going to write about the Moral Monday movement that's going on in North Carolina right now, actually, with Reverend William Barber.
And interesting.
Who I work for.
Oh.
And, but the most important thing I learned in this book was that it's not the horror story that matters as much, because we've always got the horror story. Trayvon Martin, Walter Scott, Eric Garner, Sandra Bland. You know how long I could go on. We've always got the horror story. The question is what you did with it. Mamie Till took her private agony, made it into a public issue, and with great, not just courage, but she was politically astute, and she harnessed the power of Black Chicago, the Black newspapers and magazines, the Black labor unions. The Black political machine was probably the most powerful Black political organization in the world, the Dawson machine. She harnessed all that, and those things had national reach.
So that
and
her son's,
that made a movement happen.
Yeah, her son's
and that,
death wouldn't.
That brought about, that toppled the system of, you know, that her son's murder was an inevitable byproduct of. Mm. He was not the first boy lynched in Mississippi, but he was from Chicago, and his mother was angry and hurt, but also wanted to make his life meaningful by changing things.
She surely did that, didn't she, when you think about it?
Change things, we have to remember, we've got to take what we got and turn it into what we need. It was not just courage. It was also
strategy.
Yes, strategy about power, about having the power to change the world.
Timothy Tyson, the book is called The Blood of Emmett Till. It's a phenomenal book. Thank you so much for joining
us.
We appreciate it.
It's good to be with you. I appreciate
it. Likewise.